And he says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. The heavenly calling is salvation. We already know the holy calling, 2 Timothy 1:9, it is sanctification. Holy, meaning we use for God only. And then the high calling, pressing towards the mark for the prize of the high calling, that is sonship. So he uses the term holy, heavenly calling, because we are saved. He says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider. We understand that the word consider means what? To ponder, pay attention to, think about, look at, see, and say who he is and I am his. Oh, that helps me so much. Mickey, I'm telling you, my brother, Mickey is my sergeant. We were in the military together, and he's still my sergeant today. Praise the Lord. Hey, amen. But the beautiful thing about that is when we think about, when he says consider, he's telling us to ponder, pay attention to, think about, look at, see who he is and say who he is and say I am his. And when you say I am his, you belong to God. You're in God's family, and God will take care of you. The Lord Jesus takes care of you. So he says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession. The word profession there is the same Greek word as the word confession. Your confession becomes your possession. You have what you say. So the word profession is the same as confession. And what does confession mean in the Greek? How do we pronounce that? What is it? See, this is what I love about the Christian House of Prayer. And it's important for you to be able to know this so you can preach this. You say, well, that's Bishop Holcomb's message. Well, then why am I preaching it to you? Praise the Lord. No, homologeo. Homo means same. Homo means same. Legeo means speak. So we are to speak the same thing that he speaks. This is how we grow up in the kingdom. We learn the language of our Lord and Savior, who is our master. And so he tells us the profession of Christ Jesus. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, confession, Christ Jesus. The power of confession is in the person of confession. Jesus said in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, before he left the earth, he said, all power, say it, all power, one more time, all power. No one has more power than the Lord. All power is given unto me. And then he commissioned and commanded his disciples to go ye therefore and preach this gospel to every creature. What is he telling us to preach? Preach what I preached. When Jesus was born into this world, the Son of God became the Son of Man, born into this world. What did he do? He went out into the highways, the byways, the lanes, and the streets of the cities, and he preached the gospel unto them. And now he's commissioning his disciples to do it, and we are his disciples, and he's commissioning us to do the very same thing. I want you to go in your Bibles to the book of John chapter 1. I'm going to be going through all kinds of scriptures tonight because I want you to be able to rehearse what we have been going through this year. And this is the rudiment of what the Christian House of Prayer is all about. This is the rudiment of it in terms of our confession, saying what God says by faith. This is the rudiment of the Christian House of Prayer, that we all speak the same thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10, he says that we speak the same thing of the same mind and of the same judgment. We speak the same thing, and there's power in agreement. Amen. In the Gospel of John, the first chapter, look at verse 23. Here is John the Baptist. He was the forerunner of the Lord Jesus Christ, meaning he went before the Lord to prepare the way for the Lord to come. And they questioned John and said, are you the one? Are you the one that the prophets spoke about? And John says, I am not the one. Say that. I am not the one. Hallelujah. One more time. I am not the one. Praise the Lord. Keep that in your vocabulary, Sammy. I am not the one. In other words, somebody may be bothering you and say, I'm not the one. I'm not the one. Amen. So John said, I am not the one. He said, the one that's coming after me, he is the Messiah. He's the one. But listen to what he says in verse 23. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. Now, what he was saying was, I am the voice. See, Jesus is the Word. In John chapter 1, where we are right now, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Jesus made everything. Jesus is the Word. He's called the Logos, and when the Spirit speaks, it's the Rhema. But Jesus wants us to know he is the Word. But what does the Word need? The Word need a voice. And John says, no, I'm not the one, but I'm the voice. I'm the voice of the one crying in the wilderness. God wants you to know who you are. You are the voice. Hallelujah. See, the Word need a voice. If you don't speak the Word, if you don't speak the Word, if you don't speak the Word. You know, in Matthew's Gospel chapter 8, verse 8, praise the Lord, there was a centurion, and he came to Jesus for his servant to be healed. And Jesus says, I'm going to come to your house. And he said to Jesus, he says, I don't need you to come to my house. I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. All I need you to do is what? Speak the word only. That's all. Speak the word only. And Jesus was intrigued with this man's faith. He said, look at this man's faith. He's telling me all I got to do is speak the word only. He said, that's all you got to do. He said, because I have soldiers and I can tell them to do this and they'll do it. And he says, I have servants and I tell them to do this and they do it. In other words, he don't treat his soldiers like he treat his servants, and he don't treat his servants like he treat his soldiers. But what he was saying was, the centurion was saying that I can give a word to a soldier, a command, and he would do it. All I need you to do, because you are the commander and the chief, just speak the word and it shall be done. And Jesus spoke the word and the man's servant was healed. Somebody give God a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so we are the what? Voice. Say, I am the voice. One more time, I am the voice. See, it's the same way, Harvey, like water has to get to us. Well, we need a pipe. And so we're the pipe that caused the water to get to the people. We are the pipe. We are the voice. Hallelujah. And the Bible teaches us something that's very special. And I want you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12. Told you there's going to be a lot of verses of scripture now. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12. We're talking about the person of our confession who gives us the power of our confession. And confession is homologeo, speak the same thing, say the same thing. Praise the Lord. Now, this is a trilogy I'm getting ready to show you here that makes up what is called confession, the trilogy. And the trilogy consists of, listen, it consists of this. And so many Christians, we get saved and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, but Carter, we never do what he's telling us to do in terms of we have to train our hearts to believe. See, your heart will not naturally believe. That's why some people are still stingy, whether it's with their money, holding on in this, because your heart does not believe. And in order for your heart to believe, you must train your heart to believe. Because like it is in the world, as it is in the world it's seeing is believing. I won't believe it until I see it. But in the kingdom, we live above sea level. It's not what we see, it's what he say and we say, and then we see what he says to us. But in the world, as I won't believe it until I see it. But we live above what? Sea level. We live above sea level. It's not what we see, it's what we believe, and we have to train our hearts to believe. How do you train your heart to believe? Number two, by teaching your mouth to speak. You have to teach your mouth to speak in order for your heart to actually believe. You train your heart to believe, you teach your mouth to speak, Deacon Frank, and then you transform, because when you train your heart to believe and you teach your mouth to speak, it's an automatic transformation. Your mind is transformed to think. Train your heart to believe, say it. Train your heart to believe. Then do what? Teach your mouth to speak. Then do what? Transform your mind to think. Think what? Think, listen, principle. Then when you think principle, and I'll show you that in just a moment, but when you think principle, then you think positive. And when you think principle, that is the principles of God, then you think positive, because God's not a negative God. God is a positive God. Whatever God says, and as you say it, it causes you to be positive. So when you think, as it were, principles of God, then you think positive, and then you think possible. All things are possible with God. Nothing becomes impossible. Whatever situation you're going through, that's why God is a God of signs, wonders, and miracles. If a person need a miracle, they can receive a miracle if they can conceive the miracle. See, you can't, listen, you can't believe what you can't conceive. If you can conceive it, then you can believe it. If you can believe it, then you will receive it. My. Just conceive that. Hallelujah. Now, this is what he says in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12. Are you there? Verse 34. This is Jesus speaking. Now, before we go there, verse 34, let me just back up to show you something. What John the Baptist said. Now, we're talking about the Pharisees and the scribes. Say the Pharisees and the scribes. And what John the Baptist called them, I'm not going to go back. I'm just going to start right there, chapter 12. But John the Baptist was the first one that said, oh, you generation of vipers. Do you know what generation mean? It's like we're in a generation right now. But what are vipers? Snakes. He said, you generation of snakes. You're a bunch of snakes creeping and crawling around here, biting folk, doing all kinds of stuff. He said, you generation of vipers. Listen to what Jesus says. Oh, verse 34, oh, generation of vipers, snakes. See, he's speaking to what they are. He said, oh, generation of vipers, listen to this. How can you, being evil, speak good things? And this is the way it is today. You got people that's murmuring, complaining, whining, crying, arguing, fussing, fighting, fretting, disobedient, rebellion, and stubborn, and they're wondering, why ain't nothing working for me? It's because you are a complaint. Instead of you saying what God said, you saying what you see, what you feel. Well, this is what I feel. It ain't about your feelings. Do you realize that Jesus never mentioned feeling, not one time in his vocabulary? It was all about faith. It was not about your feelings. Feelings come and go. You are up and down, in and out about your feelings. I don't feel this. I don't feel that. And he's not calling you to have feelings. He's calling you to have faith. And he says, oh, generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? You can't. See, because when the squeeze is on, Richard, when the squeeze is on, what's going to come out? If you got a lemon and you squeeze that lemon, somebody say lemon juice will come out. Lemonade will come out. That's not all that comes out. If somebody injected strychnine poison, not only are you getting lemonade or lemon juice, but you're getting some poison. And he's saying that when the squeeze is on, even people who have received Christ, they don't realize that's why God allowed the squeeze to be on us, because all of a sudden language come out of their mouths. Ooh, ha. Cuss words, fuss words, all kinds of stuff. Husbands and wives, I mean, words come out of your mouth. He says, wait a minute, you generation of vipers, how can you, be an evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. See, it's what's in your heart abundantly will come out of your mouth eventually. And this is how you, listen, this is how you know by way of confession what is in your heart. See, the whole purpose of confession is to reveal what's in the heart and to release faith from the heart. But when you reveal what's in the heart, if it's negative, then God is telling you, you got to get your heart right. He says, O generation of vipers, how can you be an evil? Speak good things, for out of the abundance of the heart, listen, the mouth speaketh. Then he says, a good man out of the good treasures of the heart bring forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasures bring forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word, non-productive word, every idle word that man shall speak, they should give an account thereof in the day of judgment. Why? Listen to this. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. It's by your words you are justified, or by your words you are condemned. You have to train your heart to believe by teaching your mouth to speak, and then your mind is transformed to think principle. Think positive. Think possible.